think we are not only optimistic, which means we think this is not going to happen to me, right? You know, I'll be fine. I don't need to go to medical screenings because I won't be sick. And we're also overconfident. And we think even if something negative will happen, I will sort it out. And this is partially related to the fact that we think we have control over events that we don't necessarily have control. And that does have these negative consequences that you talk about, which is not putting a belt on when we're driving, not putting a helmet when we cycle, not buying insurance, and so on. And that is a part of optimism that I think we need to be careful of, we need to be aware of, and maybe correct for. And especially not only on an individual level, but we see it very strongly when people come together, such as in financial markets. We know that the 2008 financial downfall was partially related to people being overly optimistic. And these are many, many, many individuals in different levels, right? From just individuals just buying houses or investing up to financial analysts, up to government officials. And these kind of optimistic tendencies of everyone together brought about this tendency where people thought the market would go up and up and up. And even so, there was evidence to suggest otherwise, that was largely ignored, which then led to the downfall. So I think it is important to be aware of it and try to develop ways that that can protect us, both on an individual level and also in a market and global level. So like most things, whether it's behavioral tendencies or physical tendencies, most things are both genetic and a result of the environment. And so there are genes that have been identified to be related to optimistic tendencies. So I think to some extent, we're born with a tendency to be more or less optimistic, and that's determined by our genes. But obviously environment is important as well. So for example, a gene, most genes actually, if you have one, most genes related to optimism, so there's maybe two or three that have been identified. If you have one type of that gene, you're more likely to be optimistic. If you have another type of that gene, you're more likely to suffer from depression. However, it's been shown that you are likely to suffer from depression if you have that gene, but plus if you have stressful life events. So it's a combination of the two. So that does not mean that if you have, you know, the gene that was related to depression, you're doomed, right? I mean, your environment matters and things can be changed. So it is the combination of the two, and there's things that we can obviously do about it. What we are working on is biological ways to change optimism. Both to enhance it and also to reduce it, not necessarily because we want to reduce it, because if we learn how to reduce it, we then learn about the mechanism that might be going on in depression. But there's other psychologists that try to work on ways to enhance optimism in more of a cognitive behavioral way. For example, Martin Seligman, that's one example. And the good news is that most of the population is at least mildly optimistic. So about 80% of the population, whatever way you look at it, tend to have a slight optimistic bias. The thing is that most of us are not aware of it. So a lot of people think they're realistic or even pessimistic, but actually we do have a slight optimistic bias. So I guess that's the good news. Most people are more on the optimistic side and have the tendency to expect things to be slightly better than they end up being. There's two ways by which imagining and expecting things to go the way that we want them makes them go that way. The first is that if we, as you said, as the skier before he skis, he imagines exactly how he is going to go down the hill and every moment and how he's going to do that successfully. It's a way, by doing that in our heads, it's a bit like training physically. So when we train physically, the more times you go down the hill, the better you'll be. But we can also do this mentally. of course, not only. I mean, you can't never ski down the hill and just imagine it and then you're fine. But the more times we go for it in our brain, the better that we are going to be, because it's like a sequence that the brain generates, right? So you're strengthening that sequence, and so then when you do it, you're more likely to do it correctly. And you're also identifying the exact actions that you need to take in order to do it successfully. You're also identifying what may go wrong. You know, so before, for example, going for a job interview, you may think about the questions and then prepare the answers and how you do it and do it well. And then when you do it in real life, you actually practice it already in your mind, so you're more likely to do it well. And B, if you imagine yourself doing it well, you're then more motivated. So you get up in the morning for your job interview, you're more motivated to put on your nice clothes and you know, prepared to give the answers that you need. And again, this is something that we do automatically. So we automatically go for things in our heads before we actually do them, even if we don't notice it. And it's because that makes it easier.